Hold on, just a second.
Holding.
What's that for?
Here. Hold this like this for a little second.
Like this?
Yeah, you know what that is?
No.
That's your play button. We're gonna fix this in post. Don't worry, buddy. It's a play button. It's a play button.
Thank you so much, everyone. Because of you, this channel has hit this huge milestone of 100,000.
120,000.
120,000 subscribers. So I'm here to celebrate that with a little Q&A. I also want to send a special thanks out to my GitHub sponsors who made this possible. This is a new thing that I've added recently. So if you'd like to support my mission to create helpful content, links are in the description below. All right, on to the questions. Oh, Kenneth Rodas is asking, why is the channel's name Coder Coder? I had no idea how to name it, and I'm kind of terrible at naming things, so I just wrote this really long list down in a notebook of like possible names. So let's go on a little journey back in time. Names: Web Dev Journey, not bad. Better Web Developer, Skillful Coder, Better Dev, Better Coder Life, Practical Web Dev, that's a pretty good name. Dwelling on Dev, Dev Reflection. Irrational Dev, Better Off Dev. Well-rounded Web Dev, Coder Catalyst. Ooh, that was actually kind of cool. I'm kind of having some regret now. Went through a lot of names, finally landed on Coder Coder, because it's kind of like I'm helping coders code, so it's like a coder coder. This question is from Shiv Bond. Hey, please launch your VS Code theme as a 100K gift. Sweat, smile, pray hands. Actually, I've already launched the VS Code theme. So if you go to the Visual Studio Marketplace or in your VS Code, the extension marketplace, type in Coder Coder and you should see my theme, Coder Coder Dark, pop up. Okay, this question is from Sarab Negi. Not a question, but just wanna say that you look like Smriti Mandana, an Indian female cricketer. I actually get this comment a lot. And since so many different people seem to think I look like this cricket player, I did look up the photo of this cricketer, and I don't think I look that much like her, but who knows? Maybe we're related.
But have you ever seen them in the same room at the same time?
Paula Fernandez Tevez is asking, do you know how to play an instrument? Greetings from Peru. I would like to be a front-end developer. Awesome. I can play guitar. I used to play violin. And yeah, that's pretty much it. This is from Dennis at LeCode Alchemist. Question, what advice would you give someone trying to master CSS? Is it necessary to learn things like floats or just start with modern CSS? I've been struggling a lot and just need some direction. Yeah, mastering CSS takes a long time, and to be completely honest, there are properties in CSS that I don't know or use. Float is still a very good, useful property, but only for certain things, like when you have an image and you're wrapping text around it. That's probably the only time that I would use float. I would learn float because it is still useful, but definitely don't use it for layout. Stick with Flexbox and Grid for that. Here's my question. How do you learn to know when to use the various CSS properties? The amount of properties in CSS is intimidating, and I'm afraid when I want to start my own project, I'll get stuck in not knowing what to use. When you're starting out, it is good just to start with the basics, you know, like the fonts, colors, position, things like that. One way you can learn is by studying existing code. So code that you know is probably built with best practice. If you use any framework like Bootstrap, you can study the CSS that they use and see how to do it yourself. Which frameworks would you suggest for someone who has only used HTML, CSS, and vanilla JavaScript so far? So I'm not sure if you're asking about CSS frameworks or JavaScript frameworks, but for JavaScript frameworks, since they're really popular, I would recommend either React or Vue. Angular, not so much maybe right now, but I think it depends also on your end goal. So if you're trying to apply for jobs, then I would see what frameworks tend to be used in your area, because it does vary by geographic area sometimes. And as far as CSS frameworks, I think Bootstrap is probably a good choice. I know Tailwind has gotten really popular recently. Yeah, definitely only move on to using those frameworks after you've learned at least the basics of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Okay, this question is from Digital Tech. How to earn money online from coding? There's a lot of ways you can earn money online from coding. One is to get a remote job at a company. You can also be a freelance coder, so finding your own clients and then working with them online. My friend Florin Pop has an ebook about 10 plus ways you can earn money coding, so we'll probably link to that in the description or something. All right, Heba is asking, are tools like Wix and WordPress killing front-end development? They are not, and the reason for that is, let's say you have a client for freelance. You have a client who wants you to make a Wix site. Well, there's a reason that they're asking you to make the Wix site for them, and it's because they are not tech savvy at all. Even if they do know how to set up a Wix or WordPress site, inevitably down the line, they're going to want to add some kind of feature or change the color of the title or whatever it is, and they have no clue how to do that themselves, and they need to hire a web developer to do that for them. So honestly, Wix and WordPress are great site building tools. I think they're good for freelance options just because you're not building everything from scratch. But yeah, it's not at all killing front-end web development at all. This question is from Anna Ureri. How do I create a portfolio if I've had no work experience? It's a really good question, and I do get asked that quite a bit. Even if you don't have work experience, like a paying client or anything, you can still build demo websites and put that in your portfolio and show to prospective employers, because all they really care about is that you have the skills to build a website. So I'd recommend sites like frontendmentor.io, also Code Mentor Dev Projects. They're good places to find free projects for you to build, and you can add those to your portfolio. Let's see, this question is from Kinyua Kaigi. Congratulations from Kenya. I love your time-lapse video when you were implementing the UI. Sorry, I have to go. There's a lion chasing after my sheep. See you when I'm done negotiating with him. Oh, I hope you got your sheep back from the lion. Okay, this question is from Stephanie Lin. What would you recommend for practice or gaining knowledge outside of small coding practices? Should I practice HTML and CSS? Is there any basic knowledge that I should know for front-end jobs that aren't typically covered? A couple tips for this is when you're learning from a tutorial or something, I would not just watch it the whole way through, but kind of pause when the teacher has sort of reached the end point of a section and then try to rebuild any examples that they have built after they've gone through it and see just how much you remember yourself without looking back at what the material said. You can find websites like Frontend Mentor, like I've mentioned in the past, to get some free projects that you can code, and it's good, really good for practice. I do a lot of YouTube videos on those. As far as knowledge, I think one of the most important things when applying for jobs is just to be a good communicator. I think that's a really important skill that not everybody has. So yeah. Okay, Brenda Michelle is asking, any tips for growing on YouTube or creating coding videos? If you're trying to grow on YouTube, the most important thing is to figure out what your audience is. So for example, the audience on my channel is beginner web developers. That's kind of the most important thing, is picking your niche, finding your audience, and also seeing what they struggle with and what pain points they have, and creating videos to solve those. This question says, hey, your content is great, love your creativity. For your animations in the videos, what platform did you use to do the 8-bit video game one? That was After Effects.
Correct!
So I think there was some kind of 8-bit filter that was used for that. Basically the entire Adobe suite, I would say. Okay, Maya Loves Codes asking, or saying, your editing is so good, and then asking, any tips or classes that you took? Again, my husband, the creative genius, is a professional videographer and editor. One class he did take was School of Motion for, I believe it was After Effects stuff. So I think that's a good place to at least check out if you are kind of getting into video animation. All right, so this question is from Fa Code. Tips for more confidence and imposter syndrome. Also, how do you know if being a programmer is for you? Just know that it's totally normal to struggle with imposter syndrome, and just know that it does get better over time. I think it took me maybe 2 years of working full-time before I wasn't struggling like a huge amount with it every day, but I do still struggle with imposter syndrome even today, and I've been working in the industry for several years. And as far as knowing if being a programmer is for you, I think as you keep learning and working, if you find that you enjoy it more than you hate it, then maybe that's a good sign that it's a good fit for you. Okay, this question is from Layla. How to improve logical reasoning skills in programming? That's a tough one. As you practice and build things and do programming more, you can sort of see how things work. It's almost like, you know, learning a foreign language. It takes some time to immerse yourself, and then you can see patterns pop out and things like that. I will say that one tip I have for the logic part of coding is when you have a problem that you're dealing with, try to break it down, and then you can kind of attack each of those smaller ones individually, which makes it easier than trying to solve the entire big problem all at once. So yeah, break big things down into small things. Tomas Vien is asking, do you incorporate any templating language in your dev stack, and do you use any keyboard shortcuts with VS Code? I don't always use templating languages. I am actually using it in my blog. It's a WordPress blog, but I'm using this Timber plugin, which uses the Twig templating language. And then keyboard shortcuts with VS Code, yeah, I try to use some of the Emmet shortcuts. I actually have a video on that on my channel if you want to see the ones that I tend to use the most. Well, that's all the time we have for today. So thanks again for your support, and I'll see you next time.